Hello, everyone. Welcome to the series Mud Talks, using an innovation mindset to problem solve an ONP with Jimmy Capra. My name is Vanessa Chu, Assistant Director in the Office of Alumni and Parent Relations. We thank you for attending today's event, and we hope you're excited. This talk is being recorded and will be distributed after the event. Please feel free to type your questions in the Q&A box, not the chat, and we will try to get through as many questions as possible. Jimmy, co-founder and Chief Executive Officer of Click Medical, partnered with Joe Mahone 6 years ago with a vision to change the lives of millions of people with disabilities around the globe through prosthetic and orthotic adjustability. Now, I'm going to turn it over to our speaker to tell us more. Jimmy, the floor is yours.
Hi, everybody. Thanks for joining tonight. I'm excited to have a conversation with you guys about innovation and how you might bring innovation into your life, into your schoolwork, into your businesses, even into your personal life. And tonight is it's a fun just kind of conversation that'll be of a different flavor than you might normally have seen on how innovation works and how you might actually get into a mindset that allows for you to innovate. So this is a relatively small group. I'm happy to answer questions along the way and talk and discuss these concepts. So please, if you have any questions, happy to answer them. Just raise your question in the Q&A box and I'll try to keep an eye on that as I give the talk. Okay, let's go ahead and get started here. And quick little update on who I am. Jimmy Capra, listen, I'm just a normal guy who's loved doing business pretty much throughout his life. For whatever reason, I thought it was a good idea to start a business when I was 8 years old. I did that business, literally just a fairly sizable lawn care business. Ran that for 23 years and really cut my teeth in how to grow a business and what it takes to run a business. I spent much of my next years going to college and thinking I would be a doctor, trying to innovate that space as well. In the end, that wasn't the path for me, and I ended up just working in a leadership position for the Colorado Outward Bound School, where I took kids on leadership expeditions for 30 days at a time out in the woods. Learned a lot about how to solve problems and look at things in a different way through that experience. And then I spent 13 years in product development, sales, business development at the company BOA Technology. BOA, you may be familiar, the company that makes little wind-up reels that close shoes and boots and snowboard boots and things like that. We've now taken that into Click Medical. Been founder and CEO of Click Medical for 8 years, actually. And I'm going to show you kind of what I've learned in that process here tonight. So let's just talk for a moment about innovation. This is a big word. Innovation is used all the time in our culture. It is one of those words and one of those spirits that people are really thought of as heroes for being a part of. They've grown huge careers, massive portfolios, incredible companies that all revolve around innovation. And so this is interesting because it then comes with a lot of pressure. Innovate or die, you might have heard. Maybe true, but gosh, puts a lot of pressure on you. The word innovation can often come with a lot of judgment. We're in the healthcare space, and a lot of times people talk about using only the most innovative products to deliver the best available outcomes in a medical setting. Whew, people's lives are on the line, right? Or their well-being. And so you have to be careful about what it is that you offer, and innovative approaches are new and they're different, and that can be very challenging despite the pressure that you deliver them. Innovation can also make you feel terrible about yourself. Am I a leader or am I a follower? This is a big question about who we are and how we present out into the world. And this is a measuring stick that is sometimes used that I would argue often leads us into a place where we don't feel good about ourselves or what we're doing with the work we're involved in. And so that can lead to more pressure. I'll make one last argument that even Charles Darwin thought of innovation and the ability for a species to change as an incredible part of who might even exist and procreate and be a part of the future of the world. So, you know, there's a lot of pressure when we talk about innovation. But what is innovation really? And that's what I want to talk to you about tonight. What is it and how do we think about it? How can we enter into a mindset of innovation that isn't so pressure filled, but is really more exciting and productive in that innovative way? I could tonight talk to you all about the four quadrants of innovation, or the 10 different steps of how to bring innovation into a company, or the innovation wheel that allows for you to delineate what steps of innovation you're in. But I would argue that these are innovation killers. This is the academic viewpoint of what innovation might be. And I don't think it actually works that way. I would rather for us today to really feel innovation. I mean, feel it inside of us, our emotions, our bodies, feel it in our heart. But I will ask you, does innovation feel like this? Soft and cuddly and warm and soaking up the sun? No, innovation is scary. It's edgy. It's exciting. It's so full of promise, but it's loaded with unknowns, and the risk is palpable. The risk is so palpable when you are in a space where you're truly innovating something. Most likely what you are going to innovate around won't work. And that brings a lot of feelings as well. So we end up running into a lot of roadblocks. We stop ourselves. We keep ourselves from doing what we are planning on doing. We put it off for later. We avoid even talking about these neat ideas. We often tell ourselves we're not good enough. You know, you're not as good as Steve Jobs or Elon Musk or whoever it may be. Lots of reasons to stop. Now, you'd even be interested to see, as you look at an innovation change curve, this is one academic part that I do like. You can see the evidence of this stoppage process of how the innovation cycle is difficult, because indeed that change curve is the, look at the first four words: shock, denial, frustration, and depression. Ooh. Is that what we're signing up for? Is that what you want when you're trying to think of a brand new and interesting way of doing something? It may not be what the culture tells you, but indeed, these are the things that we start to go through. And I want to open up the conversation about them because they are meaningful in the process of innovation. Now, what makes us resist? What makes us feel all these feelings? Mostly it's fear. Fear of being vulnerable, you know, coming up with an idea that maybe someone doesn't like or doesn't think is very good, or coming up with an idea that your boss or your teacher or your spouse might not enjoy or think is worth pursuing. You might just not like the risk. It may be too risky, too costly, too difficult to bring into the world. This is a big one I like. Conditioning. There's a lot of conditioning. We are grown up when raised in a culture where there are certain rules. And many of these rules are the conditions by which we are taught to live. Innovation is not, it doesn't follow the rules. It doesn't follow the known. And so when we start to get into innovation in an innovative mindset, we run into this conditioning a lot, and it tells us to stop. We also run into convention. This is a big one that, you know, you would think would be easy to overcome. But just simply, this is how it's done, or this is the way we do it, or You know, here at Harvey Mudd, this is the way that things run, or what you are expected to accomplish, or what you're expected to do. These are big conventions, and they aren't necessarily aligned with the innovative mindset, and so they can stop you. We often then run into these elements, and we start to waver a bit, and we put our time into other priorities, or we just say, hey, I don't even have time to think of these great new ideas. We don't have time to think about this. And that then basically stops the process. And then our innovative process kind of looks like this. Not very productive, not very innovative. So the question is, what do we do? How do we get into a place where we might actually be able to really think in an innovative fashion? And that's the heart of this conversation, and one that I want to talk about here next. I'm going to just stop and check if I can the question and answer box. I think it's all clear so far. Okay. So sorry, Vanessa, my mouse doesn't like it when I'm in presentation mode. And okay, there we go. All right. So what are we going to do? We are going to step into an innovation mindset. Now, this is something that you can do when you're getting ready to study for finals, or if you've got a paper that you need to write that has a new idea in it. This is something you can do to generate new ideas for Friday night. It's a great step to take if you are needing to change something in your life, personally or in a relationship. This is a great way to bring innovation into your life. So I'm going to show you how this is done. The first thing we need to do is literally just step into a place of courage. Now, if you'll just bear with me for a moment, this is easy to say, but it is not easy to do. For all of those fears that we just talked about truly do emerge, especially when you're starting to take an actual step into a place where you feel like you're going to do something new. So what I would ask you to do is just close your eyes for a moment, take a deep breath, think about all those fears that might show up when you are going to try something new, and just acknowledge them and just say, hey, I see you. I see that you're here. What I'm going to do is ask you, let's just relax, just even for 10, 15 minutes. Let's let courage really rise up within us, and let's let it drive for the next 15 to 20 minutes. Let's just do it. This is not so hard. It's not so scary. Let's just turn on courage. And with that, it will really help us to step out of our comfort zone and into a place where we can try new things. And that is the place where innovation really occurs. Now, if we're ready, we can take a couple of small steps. Those small steps, step one, literally you're just going to take stock. This is such a great exercise. Again, whether you're talking about a new paper or a date you want to take someone on, or a brand new business idea, it's a great step to literally take out a piece of paper and write down what is certain and what is not certain. Here's what it allows you to do. The certainties are things like clear or slow-moving trends, well-understood trajectories of change that are happening in your world or in this particular place, things that have high impact to the situation. You know, this is economics. This is, you know, social trends. These are things that you know and you can count on. They're changing, but they're slow enough that they can be counted on. They're certain. Write down things that are certain, and those certainties will allow for you to bounce off of them and kind of keep your bearings when you're really starting to challenge the status quo. With those certainties, you also can make urgent adaptations because you know what's happening. Now, this is very different than the uncertainties. Uncertainties are the big surprises. They're the disruptive forces that really change things that we had no idea were coming. I was just talking to Vanessa about COVID and whether COVID had an impact on my company. Definitely an uncertainty, definitely a disruptive force of change. It had big impact for impacting the company. And many different outcomes could have occurred. Now, we didn't know what was happening there. None of us really did. So where you can really gain a lot of a tool here is by writing down things that are uncertain. And then to follow that up, try to understand what signals you might notice over time that would allow for you to understand what those forces of change are doing. Is it getting better? Is it getting worse? How would I know? These are important things. You can do this in 10 minutes and you can do it on a piece of paper, draw a line down the middle of it, write down your certainties, write down your uncertainties, and then you at least have a line in the sand. And this is really useful for going back to when you start generating new ideas to see if they're going to fit. So that's step one, take stock, certain versus uncertain. Now, two, this is more of a mindset, and I want you to adopt the innovation mindset tools. Here they are. There's three of them. One is to get comfortable with ambiguity. Two, prepare to be resilient. And three, apply your imagination. Now let's talk about each of those real quick. Getting comfortable with ambiguity. Listen, this is just the most important one in my mind because what you are going to enter into when you innovate, whether you're thinking about something small and intangible, what should I take someone on a date, or whether you're thinking about something big, there's going to be ambiguity all over the place. You don't know if these ideas will work. You don't know if the idea is good. You don't know if people will understand your idea. You don't know if people will buy your product. The only way to do that is to try and to get into a state where you are failing and trying and failing and trying and failing. And the beauty of that is that that's the place that we as humans really learn. We learn by failing and then not liking that feeling and trying again, learning, failing, and succeeding finally. So failure is an option. Failure is the right track. Failure is what brings on the shock, depression, the other words that I'm forgetting right in this moment. In that innovation change curve, this is the part where it's ambiguous. You don't know what will happen. Just be okay with that. Again, remind yourself, courage is here, and I'm all right with not knowing all the answers. Now, if we step into resiliency, that's the next tool that is unbelievably powerful. The resiliency is what lets you pick yourself up after the failures. Resiliency is a choice. And I love this picture, because it really is that simple. If you realize that you can't do it, get out the scissors and cut off the tee. You can do it. You just got to try it again. Get comfortable with that ambiguity, muster up a little bit more courage, and pick yourself up and try it again. Now, here's the most fun part of the tools, and that's applying your imagination. I want you all to just appreciate for a moment. Think back to Cro-Magnon human beings as they were evolving on this planet. Many of those beings really had no imagination. They did not have the prefrontal cortex that allowed for them to think of things that didn't exist. They knew what they knew. They knew how others had done it in the past. They might have made small advances, but not giant leaps. It wasn't until the imagination came on board with the evolution of the prefrontal cortex in our brains that said, it doesn't matter if you've never seen it, if you've never heard of it, if you've never known it, you can still imagine it. And if you can tap into that particular quality within yourself, then you can take those new ideas and you can make something out of nothing. And that's the really exciting part. That is our superpower. So if you bring in courage, if you take stock and understand the certainties and uncertainties, and if you bring in those three tools of being comfortable with ambiguity, really bringing your resiliency up into the forefront and turning on your imagination and applying it, well, then we get to revisit all that fear and all that pressure that comes with the innovative spirit. We can overcome that fear. We can take vulnerability and we can look at it as a true strength. For when we are vulnerable, that's when we're the most truly ourselves and where the most magic can truly happen. So get vulnerable, try it out. Take that risk and turn it into a reward. There's a lot of evidence of risk leading to failure, but there's also fantastic evidence in this world of risk leading to reward. For small things, for big things, if you can bring in that resiliency and be comfortable with ambiguity, you most often will turn risk into reward. We can, instead of abiding by our conditioning, we can break barriers. Instead of going by convention, we can build huge opportunity. And if we do all of these things, well, then the right priority will be bringing your innovative idea to the forefront. And you can say goodbye to having too little time. This is important. You got to bring it forth into the world. And that will bring you to this one last topic, which I skipped earlier and is really medically oriented. But so many innovative ideas are not brought into the world because there's not a reimbursement code for them. And I think that is hogwash, because what wins every single time is value. If your idea, if your new method, if your new way of doing something brings value into the world, then it will be valuable. It will be accepted. It will find its home. And so we don't need to worry about, will somebody buy it at a particular price or will I get reimbursed at a particular amount? It's just not something we should even spend a whole lot of time thinking about. So those are the tools. Let me show you quickly how you can put it to use. I'm going to skip that. Like I said, muster up your courage, take stock, turn on the innovation tool set of ambiguity, resiliency, and imagination. And then now here's a great tool that you might use to help you think up some of the new ideas or innovative thoughts that you're looking for. Here's what it is. First, get centered and take stock with that certainty and uncertainty list. But then this second white piece of paper here allows you to take the idea, and here it's listed as the emerging technology. Like for me, it's working for how do I help an amputee? How do I make their lives better? In order to think up ideas, it's great to take the problem that you have, the problem that is in front of you, and mix it with a futuristic idea. Here, this one is just a little blurb on e-textiles. Who knows what an e-textile is? Who knows what it can do? Who knows where it'll show up in our life? We don't know what kind of ramifications it might bring. It is an uncertain futuristic idea. But if I blend a futuristic idea with the thing I'm working on, you come up then with a bunch of juicy ideas. You open up your brain to a whole bunch of different ways of thinking. And that's where some of the really beautiful, innovative concepts come from. Write them down, jot them down. This is a quick 5-minute exercise. Do it with a friend, do it in a group that you're working with. This is a great way. I would recommend trying this with three different futuristic ideas: e-textiles, flying cars, and I don't know, some other really amazing, innovative, futuristic idea. The neat part is that, and I really think this is important, the spirit by which you should be deploying this tool is to know that any useful statement about some new futuristic idea should seem at first entirely ridiculous. Every idea that you have should sound entirely ridiculous. Now, why is that important? Well, number one, if you know that that's the case, then you feel less vulnerable and scared about coming up with wild new ideas. And two, you know, there's countless examples of how people have come up with ideas that simply didn't fit the world we know, but they became the world we now live in. That is where that true innovation comes to bear in our world, where the thing that you have thought up becomes a whole new way of being. Not one that we understand today, but one we will live into tomorrow. So things should sound ridiculous. Now, if you're a leader, and a leader, there's a lot of different places you can live in a leadership position. Maybe you're a leader for a group you're in, for a company, for a team you're on, doesn't matter. Leaders need to be thinking innovatively, and they need to be cultivating innovation within their groups. And why do they need to be doing that? There's that another word that has a lot of pressure surrounding it. They need to do it because, boy, the success of your team, the success of your group may rely on fresh new ideas or new ways of approaching something. And if so, how can you cultivate that? Well, just helping people understand that an innovative mindset is allowed and cherished and celebrated within the team or the group, that's a great first start. There's kind of that old saying, there are no bad ideas or there are no stupid questions. Like, ask them. The second one, really building self-perception and self-reflection as a common tool. What this does is it allows for us to really not just say, hey, I did it, but did I do it the way I wanted to? Did I do it in the best way? Did I do it in a manner that is, you know, interesting and valuable? What parts do I like about it? What parts do I not like about it? What might I do differently if I had the chance to do this again? Those self-perceptive and self-reflective thought processes are loaded with opportunity to continue to be in the innovative mindset. And then lastly, really promote futuristic thinking, just like I did with this slide back here, and talk about the amazing opportunity for some idea that we don't understand today to become really valuable in the future. That's where futuristic thinking can add huge amounts of value to a group. There is a question that showed up in the question and answer box. I'll answer that in just a minute. We're nearly done with the talk. Here's that innovation change curve again. It's super interesting to look at this again after thinking about this innovative mindset and the innovation mindset tools. When I experience shock or denial, these are resistance elements that keep us safe, right? They are our insides telling us, no, that's too dangerous. But if we can face them and say, you know what, this idea may be shocking, or this new development may be shocking, or I really don't want to think about it. This is a great place to create alignment within the team or the group that you're working in. Just talk about, what are we actually talking about here? What is happening to us? What might we do in order to find a solution? That's going to start leading you down the path of innovating. You will inevitably run into some frustration, because we're going to fail in the process of bringing new ideas to fruition. That's a great time to really maximize communication and make sure that you guys are holding up the innovation mindset. You are allowing for that culture to exist. You are celebrating failure as a step towards something, not as a step backwards from your progress. And if you do that, you can kind of sail a little bit closer, more easily through that depression stage. And you can spark that motivation that you're going to need in order to start experimenting, start making decisions on how to use this product, and then the integration process of really getting it into whatever form is needed in order to bring it into the world. And so with all of that, I ask, can we innovate? Can we think of new ways to do things that we've never done before? Can we solve problems that are in front of us, no matter how small or how big they are? And the simple answer is yes, we can. Yes, we can. Okay, that's my take on innovation and how to get into that innovative mindset. Let me address this question real quick, and then I'm going to show you quickly how we've applied that here at Click Medical, and then we can maybe spark a couple of questions.
Great. So Jimmy, our question is innovation more of a team effort or ideally solitary? How do you manage team fear, panic, courage to keep the pieces moving?
I think that's a great question. And I would answer that in sort of two different ways. One is that the innovative spirit is really a great one to do in your own time. Sometimes when you're in your own time, you know, imagine like, for me, it's being on a bike. If I'm on a bike, my body is busy doing something. My brain is busy trying to tell me where to go and not to crash. And in that process, I'm concentrating most of my energy into that task. It actually allows the rest of my brain, my resting brain, to go out and think and dream and challenge the status quo. So that alone time for me is a really powerful way of getting into an innovative mind space. That said, we only know what we know. We can only dream as far as we can dream. When we get into a team environment, there's a lot of beauty to what can show up because of different perspectives. Whether that's different ages, different genders, different sexual orientations, different whatever, diversity tends to be a really important part of bringing really meaningful ideas to the forefront. And so you might have a great idea, but bring that into a group and have them challenge it, have them ideate around it, have them share some of their ideas. And that, if done well and done in an open, innovatively productive space, can be a really powerful way to further the innovative thoughts that you had on your own.
Great. Thank you so much.
Sure. Is that it, or is there one more? That looks like that's it. Okay. So let me show you real quickly a couple of quick ways that we've turned innovation into reality here at Click Medical. Listen, we came with a simple idea, and that's that bodies change and that they really should be able to adjust the products and the medical devices that are worn and used by patients. This is no different than enjoying the fact that you have a belt or enjoying the fact that you can loosen your shoelaces when your feet swell on an airplane, or change the position of your seat in your car because it doesn't quite fit you, or maybe you need to sit up a little straighter so you don't fall asleep, or whatever it might be. We adjust all the time in all facets of our life. And yet for prosthetics, most people in the past have had a rigid prosthetic that fits them one day, the day they get it, and never fits really that well afterwards. So we thought, hey, what if we could change that? What if we could allow for folks to adjust their prosthetic devices? And I'm gonna stop sharing here and switch to a different screen. I got a little video last night that I just thought was really a great image of innovation. And it happens to use our products in a 3D printed prosthesis for a military veteran. Here it is real quick.
We've always defined ourselves by the ability to overcome the impossible. And we count these these moments.
The first ever to fly faster than the speed of sound.
These moments when we dared to aim higher, to break barriers, to reach for the stars.
76, you are go.
To make the unknown known. We count these moments as our proudest achievements.
Having fired the imagination of a generation.
But we lost all that.
Pulls into port for the last time.
And perhaps we've just forgotten that we are still pioneers. That we've barely begun. And that our greatest accomplishments cannot be behind us. But our destiny.
So there's just a quick look at the innovative spirit, right? The ability for a vet to have an arm and coincidentally, two legs that work well for her, that allow her to work out, that allow her to walk, that allow her to do push-ups and build muscle and get back to life. This is what the innovative spirit has brought with our company and our products to people in the world. And just a couple more examples. There are, you know, the ability to make a robotic hand really work, the ability to get a device on and off simply by opening it and allowing for a limb to place down into it. Pediatrics, think of the poor little kids who have congenital or sometimes amputations due to health concerns or other elements. They have a big, big problem ahead of them. But we can help them out. We can help them out with a simple idea, which is literally the ability to adjust the socket, to wind in lace that creates pressure that closes or adjusts a prosthesis on somebody's body. And we've been able to affect hundreds of thousands of people, not only the amputees themselves, but their caregivers and their wives and their husbands and their children. It's an amazing element when somebody has just a little thing that is the right thing that then puts them into a place where they can regain their life. And that has been a great business. We've been in business doing exactly that for 8 years, honored by some of the coolest companies or, you know, publications, this one Fast Company out there for the kind of work that we do. And we've built a company and a company that, you know, not only employs, we employ 13 people, we feed all of their family. We bring jobs to the local community and the global community, and we are able to really improve lives each and every day that we're here at work. So that's what innovation can do, and that's where some of the exciting elements of what can become once you get through all those difficult parts of innovating into bringing new products and new ideas into the world.
All right. Thank you, Jimmy. We have a few questions. How do you avoid being the person who walks around saying ridiculous things all the time? Is there a balancing act? Maybe you can tell a story about your experience, or maybe you're saying don't avoid that.
I mean, it's a great question. You know, I guess just like anything else, new ideas tend to be scary, like I said. It is scary, like I said in this presentation, to think of new ideas. It puts you in a vulnerable place. It puts you in a place where you might be risking something, or where you might be flouting convention or the conditioning that we're expected to uphold. It can also go the other way, where when somebody comes at us with a new idea, it puts us in the back seat very quickly. Like, wait, why are you challenging the status quo? Why are you doing this? What do you have to gain? You know, why I feel like I shouldn't trust you. these are reactions that show up when we're challenging the status quo. So I guess I would say, if you're someone who naturally sits in a position where you like to think of new ideas, that's great. Don't stop. In fact, use these tools and do it more. The big task for you will be to learn how and when to share them in a way where you might warm somebody up to before you tell them your new ideas, right? Oh man, that's a story I'll tell. I can't tell you how many times I've come in from a bike ride running into the office and I'm like, hey, here's the idea. And everyone that I'm telling it to is not warmed up. And it hits them. They're like, oh God, now, what does he want to do now? Like, oh, I'm already too busy. He's going to throw more work at me. This is a great way to kill innovation. If I had instead walked in, sat down and smiled, they might be saying, what's going on, Jimmy? What, you're just smiling. Say, man, I got a great idea. Really? Like, what is it? Well, let me then lead make with some curiosity. What would you guys think if there was a better way to do this thing? What would you think there's value if there was this new idea? Would you buy something that looked like this? That is a way to warm people up and get them really curious about your idea. And then that's the better time to let them in to the idea. And then, of course, I'll add one last part. Being humble with it is important, because without being humble, it can be scary too. But if you're humble with it and you say, gosh, that's just my idea, what might you all be able to add to it? That's a really important invitation for them to join you in the innovative mindset that you're in. And from there, they become really excited. And that's where you get a huge amount of productivity with taking an innovative idea forward.
Great, thank you. Thanks for sharing. So that was a big change going from outward bound to making adjustable medical devices. What inspired you and how did you get others on board with you?
That's a big question. You know, and it comes with all the pressure that I talked about earlier. You know, I went from Outward Bound. I got a job, like I said in the beginning. 13 years I spent in a very innovative company doing very innovative things and being very much on the front line of creating the new ideas, the new products, everything. So I had a lot of practice in innovating. But, you know, like always, that was a job. And with jobs come golden handcuffs, paychecks, security, a lot of convention, a requirement for teamwork, all of these different things that are really good for humans, good for families, stable, but are sort of challenging on the innovation front because they're constraints to some degree. So my story personally, you know, 13 years I spent doing that with that company. And I think one of the wisest things anybody ever said to me is that no matter who you are, your time will come when you have played out your role within a company. Whether you're the founder, whether you're the owner, whether you're, you know, the mailing person, your time will come. And my time came. It was time. The forces of the world had said, nope, it's, you know, Jimmy, you've done what you've come to do here. It's time to move on. And with that time, I then had a choice to make. I had a choice to make to go find another job. Would have been a totally reasonable, far less risky, and way easier choice. Instead, I chose for something really challenging. I chose for something that really spoke to me. I chose for something that I knew I could really take a technology that I really knew and apply it in a brand new way that really helped people. And that was inspiring. It was really inspiring. So I went for it. You know, I put together the partnerships I needed. I raised money that was very difficult. I hired people. I committed to renting space and to buying inventory. All of those different parts are the really committing part, but it just happens. If it's supposed to happen, you got to do your best to trust that it's supposed to happen and then let it as best as you can.
Great. Thank you. Our next question. So what was the idea you had that didn't seem realistic when you started out?
Oh gosh, I had a lot of them. If there's certainly something that I don't suffer from, it's a lack of really, really big ideas. And I've had to learn over the years how to control that a little bit. New ideas and big ideas are sexy. They're exciting. And boy, can you put a lot of time and energy and money and effort towards them. And I'm not saying you shouldn't. I'm saying you should. That said, it is really important to take stock again about what's certain and what's uncertain. Because when you dive into the pool of entrepreneurship, it's hard to get out of that pool. You might sink quickly and then you really can't get out. You might swim, but the pool might be a lot bigger and a lot longer and a lot more expensive than you ever imagined. So you have to be careful about how big your ideas are and how close by they might be to reality. I sort of hate to say these things because they're like innovation, they tamp down the innovative spirit. But it is important to take stock along the way as you're bringing an idea into fruition that would keep things in the realm of reality. Don't worry, people will do this for you. And like if you go to raise money for an idea, oh, you just signed up for a whole bunch of people trying to tamp down on your enthusiasm, the likelihood of your success, the possibility of having enough money to do it. They're there to pounce all over it and tell you, no, it, that's a crazy idea, or it doesn't fit, or we don't like it, or whatever they may say. Those people will help you tamp down that idea and get it into a reasonable space. But I think I might be avoiding the question of what were some of the big ideas or the ridiculous ideas. You know, one of them was surrounded fracture bracing, just like a plaster cast on your arm. Those things have been made in the exact same way, maybe with tiny bits of material changes over the years for what, 100 years? I had a great idea for totally reinventing how those were made, how they were used, how they were built, how they serviced the user, so that arms would not, a lot of arms are lost from casting because the arm swells inside of them and they don't notice it for too late until it's too late, and then they end up amputating the arm. I had a big idea for that, and it was kind of ridiculous, and I brought it to market and nobody liked it. Now, I was too busy. I was doing that idea plus a bunch of other ideas plus the prosthetics idea. Oh, I was open for them all. And that's another thing that you have to figure out is how to choose and then how to focus on which idea is the most likely to progress through the process of bringing it to the world.
Great.
Hopefully I answered the question there in a very long-winded way.
It's all great advice that you're telling us in your experience. So how did you settle on prosthetics and orthopedic adjustment as the problem that you wanted to tackle?
So super quick history. While I was at Boa Technology for 13 years, I developed not only a lot of products, little reels that wind things up, but I also developed a ton of products that used those reels out in the world. I did 7 different categories of business, you know, from athletic shoes to outdoor shoes, safety shoes, lots of shoes, tons of shoes. And then I finally started putting these products into medical devices. And I realized in that process that there was 2 different types of medical devices. One is a manufactured or off-the-shelf version, which you will go and get from Walgreens or from an orthopedic doctor. The other are these custom devices that are made for people And the amputees are a great example where you can't just make a standard prosthetic socket. People are different shapes. Their limbs are different lengths. They have different sores or medical conditions. So they need to be custom. And I thought, well, truly, my partner in Click Medical called me one day and said, hey, I've got a great idea. I'm a prosthetist and I need a better way to do this. And I have a way to do it using the tensioning technology. And I said, oh, well, that is a great idea. Like, let's play with it. And over a couple of years, actually, I realized it was such a good idea that I was interested and willing to take that big leap and turn that idea. I used his innovative concept, my innovative knowledge of business, to bring together a team that was strong enough to be able to bring this into the world. So, it's so interesting. I love being innovative. That particular idea, not mine, it was Joe's. And thank goodness that he thought of it. And thank goodness that he called me one day. And thank goodness that we liked each other enough to want to partner up and bring it to the world. And that's just kind of how it happens.
That's awesome. If we have any more questions, please feel free to send us in the chat or the Q&A, and we can answer a few more before we close out. Jimmy, I do have a question for you. What is one, I mean, you've given us a lot of advice, but what is one key piece of advice or information that you want innovators, newly innovators, you know, to have and to, you know, not give up? What would you give them?
I'm going to answer that in a sort of two parts. The first part is this. We need innovation. Innovation is how we tackle problems as human beings to thrive. Whether that's to enjoy something or whether that's to thrive in sense of living. And innovation is, you know, as the human race has expanded hugely, we've needed to innovate around food production. We've needed to innovate around, you know, medical care. We've needed to innovate around transportation. We all need that innovation. There are huge problems that have resulted from those innovative ideas. And so, you know, I think of my children, I think of people who are in school right now. We need your innovation. It is paramount to solve the next set of problems that are in front of us, or to solve the big problems that have been created by people. So do it. It is really important. Here's the second part that I want to be heard, and that's that we live in a really interesting time where innovation is being really squashed. And here's what I mean by that. If you pick up your phone and you get all distracted, and you start looking up stock picks in the middle of a conversation, you start answering social media, you get 92 different notifications in 17 minutes about different things in your life, all this incoming information completely fries your brain. And the first thing that it fries is your creative spirit. So I urge you, just take a moment. Close your eyes and take some deep breaths. Be present in your world and with yourself. And do that as much as you can. Because it is from that space where truly creative and innovative ideas come from. It does not come from surfing the web. It does not come from your phone. It does not come from watching a screen. It comes from inside. So we need you. In order to do that, really get present. Find ways to really get present. And from that, amazing things will happen.
Wow. Thank you, Jimmy. I want to thank you for joining us today and for sharing your knowledge and insights with us. Thank you to our audience for your questions and for attending this event. We will follow up in within the next week with a recorded video. Up next, we do have From Chemistry to Climate Policy with Camille Sultana, class of 10, on Wednesday, October 26th at 5:30 p.m. Pacific time. If you're interested in being a Mud Talk speaker, please contact us at alumni@hmc.edu. Future events can be found on our website by visiting alumni.hmc.edu. Thanks again for joining us tonight, and have a great night, everyone. Thanks, Jimmy.
Thanks, everybody. Appreciate your time.